So that's that. I could talk about the virtues of anonymous making things on the internet and anonymously, and the fact that I can talk about it in this way is interesting. Was there a Vernon Howe, and what does that mean? Well, there's a Vernon Howe, the first Vernon Howe, we call him VH1, who's currently started writing on Facebook, facebook.com/Vernon Howe. He is not, that is not me, so I'm not Vernon Howe. And I really only recently took over the Vernon Howe identity as being the so quote unquote controller. So the last, I would say that was only in the last month that I started doing this. Before then, I was just a person who collaborated with Vernon Howe. All of the music and all of the art that you see on the website was made by this guy, and he is since retired from the Vernon Howe. He believes he's the first Vernon Howe, and that the name struck him one night, and it came down from the heavens that he had to presume this identity and create evil rock and roll music to basically as payment to the devil for keeping him out of hell. He had to do the devil's bidding on earth with the music of Vernon Howe, and he always envisioned that Vernon Howe group, which was the band I was in, and I was only a working member of the band, I was not the leader of the band, but since the original Vernon Howe, whose name, I can say it now because he's since retired, and once you give up the title of Vernon Howe, you then become your identity again. If someone's willing to take on the role of Vernon Howe, and you can look at the Vernon Howe synonymous with a Caesar, Caesar being the original. In this case, the original was Doug Smith, who still lives in upstate New York. He lives in Florida, New York, which is near Schenectady. New York, about, I guess, a half hour away. He was originally from a town called Wormington, and Wormington is the real number one origin center of Vernon Howe. That's where it started, and he started on the first couple records that Vernon Howe came out with, Doug made by himself in Wormington. Now, I, like I said, had collaborated with him for a little while, so my fingerprints are on some of the music and some of the things. I just really took over the internet presence. I switched it from .info to a .com, and I did that, it was in this new year. It was around 2012, the beginning of 2012. We were in the changeover process then, and I didn't really know when it was going to go official. So the date, as far as when I actually became Vernon Howe, so to speak, is a little unclear. And there's a little bit of contentiousness. What happened was Doug, he was from Wormington, and then we met in Jersey, in the New Brunswick area, and collaborated on music for a while there. But anyway, we collaborated on some stuff in New Brunswick, New Jersey, around Rutgers, back when I was still a Rutgers student. I kind of fell off. He recorded some more albums just on his own. We had a few other players who were involved in the Vernon Howe group. That was the origins of the band. When we formulated the identity of the band, we didn't really know what Doug had in mind for Vernon Howe as this entity that would never die, so that we always had this idea that we wanted the Vernon Howe group to be responsible for, and the Vernon Howe name, if you will, to be responsible for the most songs ever written. So one Vernon Howe would die or give it up, as in this case with Doug. He had an epiphany that he could no longer do this work for the devil, and so Doug right now is in a weird spot as far as, you know, trying to, and I've never really believed that, but if you want to go by the full myth of it, I mean, if Doug gave it up, so Doug pushed it on to me to continue making the music for as the Vernon Howe group, as a way to let evil into the world as a way to keep Doug's soul out of hell. Now, if you want to believe what Doug thinks, since I have assumed the Vernon Howe role, Doug is VH1, I am VH2. So I am Vernon Howe, the Vernon Howe. And if you want to, and if this curse is real and the devil is watching over me, if I were to stop or end doing Vernon Howe, then I would be struck down dead. I'd be struck down dead and I'd be sent to hell. So my soul would go to hell. So I'd, something catastrophic, think Final Destination movies, would happen to me and I'd be in hell, burning in hell. If I decided that I wanted to end the Vernon Howe. And also, caveat, if I were just to die without having assigned a backup or a VH3, Vernon Howe, the third Vernon Howe, to take over upon my death, I would also burn in hell if I did not have that set up and ready to go. Interesting stuff, right? Neither here nor there is the philosophy that we all shared back when the band was at its most successful, which was that we were going to try and become the most prolific act of all time. That has its roots in hell and the curse, only because obviously with the more things that we would make, the more chances people would be able to be consumed by really what is the heart of all the music that we make, which is devil only.
I'm stopped outside of a Kmart that I thought would be open because I wanted to buy a boat hat for the summer. I used to wear boat hats when I was about 20 years old, and I had this, like, you know, sailor boat, like fisherman hats, I guess. I call them boat hats. I don't know if that's accurate. But this Kmart is closed. Anyway, I've divulged a lot more than I probably ever wanted to about the history of Vernon Howe, and I see a Wendy's right here. So I'm definitely going to hit the drive-through at this Wendy's. Actually, no, I'm going to park and go in because I have to pee. And I think it'll be my 56th or 57th pee since we started the pee program. I'm going to park over here. It's a busy Wendy's. Damn. And so, let me just see where we are here in the recording. So 22 minutes. So that's 7. All right, so I'm going to stop it here, and we're going to be well into the second half. This is the second clip right now anyway, so this will be cut up, and so it'll all come back when I am done inside of Wendy's. Okay, so that was the break. A little bit of downtime in between. This is the second installment of episode 5, Drive Time Show. I didn't actually go eat food at Wendy's. I did pee there. The line was long and not moving fast, so I wasn't gonna succumb to eating Wendy's when I had to wait. It was looking like it was gonna be 5 minutes. So I got back in my car. I realized that I probably, given that they have no idea where I'm coming from, I could probably suck out a little bit more time this afternoon before I went back into the office. Yikes, a box just fell out of this car. Oh my god, what the hell is that in that box? It's a whole box. That is someone's box of something. Okay. And I was pulling out, well, anyway, so I ended up going to this, like, strip mall, and I went to a dollar store, and had not been to a dollar store in a while. One thing about where I live nowadays is the total lack of dollar stores, 99-cent stores, which I love. And this was a good one. Let me tell you, I got a, Disney High School Musical binder. It was 89 cents. I got a horse notebook, the picture I take, I think, you know, maybe it will be of the horse notebook. Little, like, notepad, but it's, like, a beautiful bound book. with one of those things you strap over to keep it closed, and you can put a pen in there. Oh, just a one of the best finds you're ever going to have. I got a couple other little notepad-y things, and a little, I got a frame. I got a little silver frame that I'm going to do something with artistically, and another little flippy thing that you put pictures in. So that was good. So I spent about 15 minutes in there at least, and then there was a deli right next door, and I had a sun-dried tomato bagel with veggie cream cheese, and a little container side of egg salad. It was delicious, but I feel a little queasy now. I feel a little queasy sometimes after I eat lunch for some reason. I think I always eat too much, maybe. I don't need to eat as much, and so I don't think that was a bad lunch. I had some coconut water as well, and some regular water, so, I mean, I also went to Rite Aid, and I bought a new toothbrush and some mouthwash. Because my teeth are rotting away. That's a whole other fucking issue. Anyway, back on the road. I'm not going to talk the entire trip back to work. I need to give myself some mental time preparation. Time to prepare. When I was pulling out of the strip mall... Damn, my stomach hurts. Oh, I feel like I get a fucking barf. I think I ate too fast. I do that. I do that at lunch. I definitely, you know what? That's what it is. I eat at lunch. I'm like a fucking psychotic person. Breakfast, I'm not a huge breakfast guy. I usually have like a protein bar, so I just kind of munch on it, and I have coffee, and it's just a little protein bar. It's not enough food, really, to make you feel one way or the other. But lunch, I'm usually fucking starving. And then at dinner, I'm usually eating with my wife or without somewhere. I'm rarely eating by myself, so I have that. You can't eat like a maniac when you're, you know, with someone else. It's just, there's rules. There's rules. Okay. So I was, pulling out of the strip mall. Did I call it a strip club before? Pulling out of the strip mall, and there is a dude out back of, and there's a strip mall, another strip mall. In New Jersey is all the strip malls, so I'm pulling out of a strip mall, and on the other side of the road that I'm about to get on, waiting for a light to turn green, there's another strip mall, and there's a dude dancing by himself, like a worker of one of the stores over there. Maybe there's a liquor store out there, so maybe he's working at the liquor store, and he's got a baseball hat on, and he's got a tank top on, though. And he's just, and there's a little, like, landing that, like, with stairs, the concrete landing in the back of the strip mall, I believe that goes into the liquor store, but maybe one of the stores next to the liquor store. I forget what's in there. There's, like, a farmer's market there. Anyway, so this guy's dancing on the little landing, and he's just fucking dancing his ass off. He's doing all sorts of crazy moves with the hat, flipping on his foot, twisting, turning, doing all sorts of craziness. Really, really going for it. So I get my camera, I get my phone out, and I start to film him. Only, I mean, the video camera, the iPhone camera limitations, when I first got it, I was, and I still am very happy with it. It's basically all I need. Wish I did a little more as far as being able to zoom in picture mode and in camcorder mode. With a little bit more clarity, you can't really zoom at all in video mode, and so I tried to film this guy dancing, and I could see him, I was picking it up, and I could see him in there, and, you know, I'll have to wait and see when I get back, and I can kind of get into editing software, and see if I can blow him up, and make some sort of video of this guy's moves that I might have captured. It was hard to tell. I was a little bit, still to this day, I don't know why I'm still self-conscious when people are possibly watching me do weird things on my phone, even right now talking in the car driving, you know. But then other times I'm just like, well, you know what? You're the kind of person who just can't care about that. It's true. It's true. I am that kind of person. So anyway, I'm behind a cop car right now. So I'll probably be behind this guy for a while on this trip. So let me cut episode 5, bring episode 5 to a close. Thanks for the continued support of me and of the program, and I will be back most likely tomorrow for Friday, Memorial Day weekend special. Have to wait and see. Thanks again.